Today on Built to Last, hammers don't just pound nails, they touch hearts.
The way that she described what she did as a carpenter is actually what sparked it for me.
And if you've ever wondered what that doohickey does, put down that remote and pick up a hammer. It's time for Built to Last. By the Chicago Regional Council of Carpenters Labor and Management Committee and Armstrong Ceilings. Faster, easier, better.
Welcome to Built to Last. I'm Monica Peterson.
And I'm Mark Nilsson. We all know that carpenters help shape the skyline and build our cities, but sometimes their most important work is done much closer to home.
On today's episode, we'll meet a boy whose life was changed by superheroes wielding hammers and saws. And later, we'll take a trip down memory lane with a group of characters who have devoted their lives to preserving the tools of their trade.
But first, as they say, the couple that drills together stays together.
For Vincent and Maria Tybor, carpentry really is a family affair.
Good girl.
Vincent and Maria Tybor have been married over a decade. But they don't just live together. They work together at construction sites like this one on Chicago's Near North Side. And Maria's reputation often precedes her.
Everybody knows my wife. I'll go to a job site without Maria, and they'll be like, "Are you married to Maria? Is that your wife?" And I'll be like, "Yes." And they tell me, "Vince, your wife is awesome. She is the trim king and queen. She is the fastest person at trim in the universe."
Long before earning her rep, Maria played college soccer. But she traded in her cleats for a miter saw, nail gun, and glue.
I'm a journeywoman. I joined the union in 2005.
Maria found her calling early in life, but her husband struggled to find his.
After high school, I did start hanging around with the wrong crowds. I started getting into things that I shouldn't have got into. I could have died. I could have definitely died or been locked up for the rest of my life. I was a child and I did childish things.
His life changed when Maria introduced herself at a party and asked Vince to dance. They soon married, and her passion for carpentry inspired Vince down the same path.
The love that she had for it, we're talking going into Menards and smelling wood, and she was like, pine. And the way that she described what she did as a carpenter is actually what sparked it for me.
Vince passed the math test and began attending the Chicago Regional Council of Carpenters Apprentice and Training Center. It's a massive complex in Elk Grove Village, Illinois, where carpenters learn literally the nuts and bolts of their profession.
Here's my 14 and 3/4. Here's my 3 5/8. You start off with basic classes of laying out a floor plan. Then you start with putting up studs. Then you go on to using any type of tools. They don't just throw you in there and say, "Here, cut this," and then you cut your finger off. They got to show you how things work.
Apprentices, as they're dubbed, begin working on construction sites in their first year, and that's when the gloves actually come on.
Safety is the number one thing on the job. The very first thing you do on a job is sit through an orientation, and they drill how important safety is. That's the first thing they do.
Vince was eager to get his feet wet, but the union brought him along slowly and steadily.
It started to get a little frustrating because I'm in my head, I'm like, I want to build something. I want to do some base. I want to hang some cabinets. I want to put some doors in. But as long as you have patience and you stick with it, my second year came and boom, carpentry took off.
Vince is now in the training program's third year. His skill set blossomed, but there's still another challenging year ahead before he becomes a full-fledged journeyman.
Stairs one was basics, just a straight run of stairs.
Now we're getting into the more difficult stuff.
What's the trick of trying to hold this up and put nails in at the same time?
Now we're working on a winder, which is like...
I love the fact that he's in the carpenter's union. We get to work together.
Is that too much?
Probably. We're putting in base, which is trim, which is the wood that wraps around the floor in your house. We compete. I'll look down the hall. She'll be like almost finishing a unit, so I start like hurrying up and trying to cut faster, and then I'll see her look down the hall. But she's just looking at my handsomeness. I'm checking out how fast she's going.
Vince and Maria might fight glue and nail on the job, but their marriage is as solid as the base they're installing.
We wake up together, we get the kids ready together, we drive to Chicago together, we work together, we take break together, we take lunch together, we drive home together.
Vince and Maria come home to a full house of future carpenters.
We have a big family. We have 6 children. They're ages from 16 to 1. Sometimes it could be challenging.
It's fun. People say that, like, wow, 6 kids, when are you going to buy a TV?
If you were stranded on an island, what 1 to 3 things would you bring on an island?
It's not as hard as a lot of people think it is.
I would bring a phone and a tablet.
I'd bring mommy.
It's great. It is. It doesn't affect work at all. It doesn't. Because as soon as you step on the job site and you put your hard hat on, it's time to go to work. It's go time.
And go time includes big plans. Vince has put his past behind him and has his eyes set squarely on the future.
I want to run work. I do want to be a superintendent. I do want to be a foreman. And the union, being in it, gives you the opportunity through going to school and learning the things that you need to learn to fulfill that dream. I feel that in my lowest point of life, when I was struggling, that the union reached down and grabbed my hand and gave me strength and a reason to have strength.
Vince wears his emotions not on his sleeve, but inked into his flesh.
I asked permission to get a tattoo of the Carpenter's logo on my neck, and she told me no, but it's my body. And I convinced her. I think I offered to clean for a couple weeks. But anyways, I got our logo as a carpenter on my neck because labor conquers everything, all things. If it wasn't for the union, I don't know where I'd be.
I'm so proud of him right now that he made it this far. And he still has some hard times with his blood problems, but, you know, he keeps on going no matter what.
At Armstrong Ceiling and Wall Solutions, we take great pride in making a positive difference in the lives of people. With the broadest portfolio in the industry and the technical performance to back it up, you can design and install with confidence. Our ceiling construction expertise, training, and pre-engineered ceiling solutions make it easy for you to seamlessly transition from one end of the building to the other. Improve construction efficiencies and keep every job on time, on budget, and on the mark with Armstrong Ceiling and Wall Solutions. Faster, easier, better.
Keeping restaurants and hotels up to date with the latest design trends is a constant challenge. Finding qualified contractors isn't at finishingchicago.com. We work with top designers and general contractors who use the latest painting, drywall finishing, and wall covering techniques in Chicagoland's premier hotels and restaurants. The hospitality industry relies on finishingchicago.com as its free resource to find quality finishing contractors. For a great finish, start with finishingchicago.com.
Now a heartwarming story of a remarkable young man and his family, and how some heroes with hammers help save them.
We always wanted to have kids, and because of medical reasons, we were unable to, so we decided to adopt.
In 2002, the Riveras were blessed with Angelica, a bouncing baby girl.
We were actually looking maybe for just like one more, but you know, there's 2 boys, they're brothers, and we said, well, you know, yeah, we could, you know, check it out. And they brought them to the house, and 2 little boys, 2 and 3, and I'm like, wow.
But soon after, Margarita noticed something concerning about their oldest son, Lee.
My dad had Becker's, which is a lighter form of muscular dystrophy. And I was seeing a lot of the things that I saw in my dad growing up in Lee. 2 weeks after they moved in, he He was diagnosed with Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, which is the most aggressive form of muscular dystrophy.
It's an illness that makes like your bones and lungs weak, and it's kind of hard to do things.
I see him talking to other kids, and other kids are seeing him in his wheelchair, and they're like, you know, why you're in a wheelchair? He'll explain, he'll tell them, you know, I can't walk anymore.
This is an illness that robs his life. It's in progression. What he could do last week, he can't do this week.
How was your day?
Along with the Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, he also has four emotional diagnoses, which are far harder to deal with than just the physical. He has mood disorder, oppositional defiance, intermittent explosive disorder, and ADHD. As Lee's condition progressed, Margarita knew she needed help. I was carrying him on my back 24 steps, from the top all the way down the stairway, all the way down to the front stairs every day. And he would go into one of his frenzies, and he'd be digging his fingers into my eyes while I'm trying to carry him down the stairs. It got to a point, it was a matter of safety. So I knew I needed help. So one day I spoke to one of my friends, and I said, you know what, I want to do a fundraiser. I need to do a fundraiser because I need to build a room for him. And we did three fundraisers, but still, we still needed some help.
Margarita called and asked if I would be able to help do the project here, and I said yes.
I have a bunch of cousins. They helped us out financially. The church we go to, St. Leonard's. Berwyn, Illinois. I'm talking about police department, fire department.
The mayor.
She just had this way about her that she just prayed that, hey, I need this, I need that, and people started coming in. We had a man that actually did all the drawings. We had people that took care of the concrete, the digging of the basement, the electricians. They all came in, so we had a whole crew, essentially, to start this project.
But even with all of the hard work and good intentions, there was still so much to do.
We didn't have siding, we didn't have roof, we didn't have insulation at that point.
With the house half finished, the Riveras needed a miracle.
And I sat in front of my computer, and God put on my heart, carpenters, carpenters, carpenters. And I typed in Carpenters Union, and God is my witness. The first phone number that showed up, that was the first number that I called.
She reached the office of Keith Judkins.
And I spoke to his secretary, and I told him my story. She said, well, I'll let him know, and he'll give you a call in about an hour. And I sat back and I said, okay, God, I'm just Margarita here. I don't think nobody's gonna call me.
We follow up on every story. We follow up on any kind of need.
Hour later, I'm talking to this man with a strong voice.
She was a person in desperation, saying she was praying for a miracle.
He said, I'm gonna have somebody out there tomorrow, Wednesday. His name is Jose Maldonado.
When Keith Judkins called me, he's like, listen, there's this project that they need some help in your area. Go check it out. Take some pictures, see what they need.
I said, oh, yeah. Oh, Margarita, nobody's going to call you.
At first, I thought it was going to be your simple, somebody needs a door change.
But I should have kept my faith.
Jose was there the next day, ready to help. But nothing could have prepared him for what he saw.
Half of the house was gone on the inside. There was no plaster, no plasters on the ceilings. There's an addition going on the outside. Walls were exposed. You could feel the draft coming in from the cold air. It was moving in the right direction, but very slowly.
He said, I'll have a couple of people here on Saturday. He said, a couple. I said, oh, okay, a couple. Which I didn't mind. Couple was good.
The first thing she told me, she's like, I can't pay these guys. I want to be able to reward them some way, shape, or form. But she's like, but I can cook.
But I cooked for only a couple. But Saturday came around, and I had 12 carpenters outside with belts and hammers and saws.
And boy, can she cook. And we have a great team of people. Keith Judkin was involved, our regional council, our president Frank Libby, Gary Perenar. They were very involved on this project. And once we started getting all the locals together, we started brainstorming, then we figured out what type of material they would need, whether it was flooring, drywall, insulation.
They started helping us financially, and they bought the insulation, they bought the drywall.
And not only did they donate all this stuff, and they came and did the work, but then they took it upon themselves to call the electricians union, to go ahead and call the painters union. You know, they didn't stop.
One pressing issue, give Lee easy access to the dining room and kitchen.
It's too big. No, that's good.
We had a wall between the dining room and the kitchen, and basically, we were just going to have it widened.
Right across here was the wall. There was only a 32-inch opening here, and Lee couldn't even come through with his wheelchair. So we went and shored up the opening, put in beams, and created this whole space to make it one large room. He could go to the back door. We have a ramp going out the back so he could go out and play.
He said, because I eat it. And she asked, why did you eat it? Why did he eat it? Because it was a piece of cake.
He could go out the front, and now in the front, we have a lift system.
Why did they go in the back? It's kind of hard because when I had to go on the school bus, I had to go down the ramp and walk all the way around. Now it's just easier.
Hold it in, okay? Don't let it come out.
Just as the work on the house progressed, so did Lee's condition.
He's choking a lot on his saliva, which means that his lungs are beginning to get weaker. He's starting to favor the right side of his chair, which means his spine has begun the curvature.
Well, before we had lunch, I ate my chicken.
Eventually, it will attack his heart. Eventually, he will need spinal surgery, heart surgery, a feeding tube, a breathing tube, and 24-hour assistant.
What we saw was that he's going to need care when he might not be able to move at all. This is where his new room is. And so in here, you'll see that we have full beams all the way across. They're all structural beams.
The child needed some special lift systems and a room to accommodate his needs. Because Margarita, the only way of transporting the young man was on her back, up and down the stairs every day.
This moves back and forth, and of course then we have the buttons that would bring it, the saddle right back down, slips it right underneath, you connect it back up, and then you can just bring it right back up. They'll pull it all the way back.
Small bathroom, it was kind of hard. When I had to wash my hands, like when I was in my chair, it's kind of hard to squeeze in there.
He has a huge bathroom where we can wheel him in. He can take a shower. There's something about dignity and being able to take a shower.
I'm so proud of him right now that he made it this far. And he still having some hard times with his blood problems, but you know, he keeps on going no matter what.
Mom, what's that dance?
There, I did it.
And if they think that the only thing they did was hammer here, hammer there, they did much more than that.
They built more than just a room. It's not just a room, it wasn't just a bathroom, it just wasn't just a closet.
There aren't enough thank yous to go around.
We work hard for a living, we make a good wage, and to share some of our experience in helping people that are less fortunate is what we're about.
It's an amazing organization. I mean, for them to take on and take away from their family time to help this little boy, to help our son, that's truly amazing.
And we sell some tools, we talk about tools. It's really a learning experience too.
Studilo, for over 125 years, has led the industry in measuring and leveling.
still manufactured in Germany since 1865. Tradesmen rely on Stabila every day for its precision and durability. We continue to revolutionize the way we build with our lasers, levels, and laser distance measuring tools on commercial and residential job sites around the world. Stabila, how true pros measure.
Meet the new family of Blaze laser measures from Bosch. Go ahead, turn it on and start measuring. It's that simple. The Blaze family offers a wide range of functions to tackle any measuring job. Extend your reach with accuracy up to a 1/16 of an inch. With Bluetooth-enabled devices, easily transfer measurements to your smartphone or tablet with free Bosch apps. Reach farther, work faster, and stay accurate with the Bosch Blaze family of laser measures. Measure on.
Welcome back to Built to Last. Ever wonder what your grandfather's old doohickey in the garage was used for?
What's a doohickey?
Let's find out.
My name is Arturo Urbano, and I'm a union carpenter from Local 13. I've been collecting since I started as a carpenter. I would go with my dad to flea markets, believe it or not, and I would see a lot of old tools. And I said, hey, listen, these are some of the tools that I see at our school.
The tools on display at the training centers remind us who we are and where we came from.
When I go back to the job sites and talk to some of the old timers, I love hearing the stories.
I was a union carpenter and I worked for Local 187 out of Chicago. I retired about 10 years ago, and I've always loved tools.
Originally, I was just looking for tools that I could use. But what happens is it sort of becomes a disease.
Our nation was built using these tools. They are things that, well, they wear, but they can be fixed and repaired.
It's the exquisite craftsmanship that existed long before our times.
It's summer, and the hand tool fanatics are coming out of the woodwork at the Garfield Farm and Tavern, a preserved, intact working farm from the 1840s just outside Geneva, Illinois.
We invited the Early American Industries Association and the Midwest Tool Collectors Association to have one of their events here.
It's our heritage. You look around at Garfield Farm here, and you see the buildings that have been restored and how people live.
The tradition of working with hands, building in particular, is reflected here by Timothy Garfield's construction in 1842 of his first barn. In February of 1842, he went out, cut the trees, hewed them into beams, and on April 13th of 1842, he had 50 neighbors come to help raise the framing of this traditional English 3.5-bay barn. By June, it was shingled and sided. So in less than 6 months, except for the sawmills that would have cut the siding and such, that building was put up without any mechanical tools.
You can see the old tools, and then you can see what they make. And you see the construction of the tavern and the construction of the barn building, and then go over and see lots of the planes and things that could have been used to make them.
We sell some tools. We talk about tools. It's really a learning experience, too. Even at my age, there's always something new to learn.
This is what they call a post vise. It's a blacksmith's vise. Everybody wants to know what everything is and what it did. And it's a challenge because there are so many unusual tools.
Every August, hundreds of enthusiasts and over 30 vendors celebrate thousands and thousands of antique hand tools.
I break it down into two basic categories. One is the collector who wants the expensive, beautiful, artistic tool to set on the mantelpiece and admire. The other thing that's probably helping the business more than anything are what people call the yuppie woodworker.
I got this maybe about 8 years ago. The first one I paid $39.
And then you'd be surprised at all the people coming looking for specific tools, people who are still making musical instruments.
Everybody has to have their own tools. They're particular
strength in crafting depend on their ability to control what those tools do. And if the opportunity comes up to buy a long wooden plane or an old Stanley joining plane or smaller hand planes, those are particularly valuable, as well as clamps and things like that that are more practical. And our products are unique in that they are tools that are used by people. At the same time, they're an artistic expression of what we do. So those tools, those traditional tools, are what helps us create.
They're young, energetic craftsmen that appreciate the tools for what they are.
Well, my favorite tool is here. I have it right here in my pocket. And it's a number one Stanley plane. And I seen it in a flea market. It was pretty rusted up when I got it. And the guy actually didn't know what he had. And now it's worth pretty good money.
There are a few tool makers out there today that are making better tools today than were ever produced in our history. But they're not affordable. And so what you can do is you can kick around here and find a woodworking plane for $15 instead of paying $4,000 for it. Yeah.
Have you ever wondered what that thingamajig you found in the attic is? These guys are experts and happy to help.
There's so many things you look at and think, what could this possibly be used for?
Just I just look at this tool, for example, and I think about who handled this one before and the kind of work he did.
Most people don't have any hands-on experience with how things were made and how things were manufactured.
Some of the best machinist tools ever made were made prior to 1840 in this country. I collect woodworking planes, and you know, the planes that were made in this country by people that fought in the Revolutionary War is just amazing.
Many of the exhibitors here today are tool and die or retired tool and die makers who actually know how a lot of these tools are and were used. And that knowledge base is an incredible wealth of resources, because hand tools are what made America.
I love it. I mean, this is my trade. This is my career. When I see a tool like this, I feel connected.
It's like a disease. Once you start collecting this stuff, and studying it, and understanding it, it grows on you. It grows on you.
That's all for this episode of Built to Last.
And remember, any tool can sit in a shed, but only a carpenter can build one.
We'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.
That was pretty good.
Visit the Built to Last website to learn about these topics and more.